Here with Nicola Caines from the editor of Brighton Indy, Brighton Hove Independent newspaper, weekly newspaper, which is out in the stands now. And we're going to talk and be talking a bit about what's going to be in that newspaper, Nicola, and the push for vaccination in Brighton. It's getting a lot of steam now, isn't it? It was pretty strong last month, but in July now, particularly with the government stepping in and increasing the vaccination rate as well, trying to do that. It's a big thing, isn't it, now, for people to go and get either their first or second jabs?
Yeah, so this week there's been the news, isn't there, the extra support from the government for Brighton because the rates are quite high. Yeah, they're kind of, it's especially between among the young people, kind of 18 to 29, I think it is. And yeah, it is a bit worrying, isn't it, when we're kind of heading towards our Freedom Day next week. So, yeah, there's a real, real big push now in Brighton and Hove. Lots of walk-in sessions for the vaccine. They've also set up two locations to go and have a proper PCR test, like symptom-free. Yeah. And again, you don't have to make an appointment or anything. Just turn up. There's one at the Peace Statue in Hove and one outside the Jubilee Library in the city centre. And also, which I know a lot of people have been desperately trying to bring forward, their second doses. So they're actually offering just walk-in appointments for the second doses now as well. They are saying it still needs to be 8 weeks since the first one, but you can walk into like the Brighton Centre, the Racecourse, lots of other venues. Yeah, all the timings and stuff, we've got them on our website and we'll have them in the paper this week as well. But yeah, just, it would be good if we can start getting the numbers down as we head towards the summer, wouldn't it? Because we all want to have a lovely summer in Brighton, especially. So, yeah, if you haven't had your jab, go and get it.
Yeah, exactly. It is quite simple as well, isn't it? I mean, when I did it at Hove Lawns 3 weeks ago now, I think, it went pretty smoothly. So it's pretty simple. And you can just turn up, which is good, because, you know, you might just decide on the day, you know, an appointment gets cancelled and you think, all right, I'll go down there. So it's always, for young people particularly, it's good that you can just turn up, walk in, queue up, get it done, and instead of keeping to an appointment.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And like we were saying, that when we were chatting, it's next week is when all the restrictions are starting to lift again, aren't they? So it's, I think the council and the local NHS are really pushing it this week so that we can kind of head into next week and feel like we're kind of back on track, really.
Yeah. What else is in the paper? Because we should say, I mean, obviously the restrictions are going to be lifted, aren't they, from the 19th of July onwards. So that's going to be interesting with these kind of this added support, which we're not entirely sure what it's the whole government support is going to consist of. But we know that there's, you know, as we were saying, increased vaccinations and, you know, and face masks in schools as well in Brighton Hove.
Yeah, I think the face masks are for year 7 and above, so kind of secondary school level. So, yeah, the schools have only got 1 week left after this anyway. So, yeah, we'll see how that goes. I am hearing a lot of schools now with classes isolating, unfortunately, just so close to getting to the summer holidays, which is a real shame for the children, because there's things like sports days and things that they're missing out on. So yeah, my little boy actually is isolating from school this week. Been making him have the lateral flow tests and they're all negative. But yeah, it's not great for the kids and stuff. So yeah, let's hope that the measures that are put in place work, really. But on a positive note, looking towards next week, we have chatted to some B&Bs in Brighton, and they're kind of feeling really positive, actually. So obviously there's been this shift, isn't there, to staycations. And yeah, I think Brighton's really going to benefit from that, because we're saying that with overbroad kind of travel, it's still not completely clear, is it, on whether all the restrictions will be lifted. So I think a lot of people have gone ahead and booked staycation type holidays. And yeah, B&Bs in our city are reporting kind of a bumper kind of set of bookings, really. And interestingly, they're saying there's been a bit of a shift in, instead of people coming for like one or two nights, there are people actually using it as a proper summer holiday and booking for a week.
Yeah.
So that's really good news for the city, isn't it? So
it certainly is, yeah. And I know we've got a lot to offer, haven't we? I know you've been out and about around the city. So Rockwater, which is obviously off of just down from Hove Lawns, near the Hove Lagoon. You went down there because that's a new area around there in terms of new attractions, isn't it? We've got we got Rockwater down there, and we've got the Hove Lagoon being spruced up as well with the community garden, etc.
Yeah, it is lovely down there. I hadn't been to Rockwater yet. I tell a lie. I'd had a coffee from one of the shacks outside when it was a bit earlier in the year. But yeah, so I went along to Saturday night. They had West End on Sea, which was all kind of people who live locally, actually, in Brighton and Hove, who are West End kind of performers, who obviously have been a bit quiet for work over the lockdown. And yeah, they came together and did this stage show, and it was on the lawns at the back of Rockwater, and it was lovely. You kind of sat out in deck chairs, so it was all social distanced and outside, and we were really lucky with the weather too, and it was really, really good. Some really good performances, some songs from Greatest Showman and things like that, and yeah, everyone really enjoyed it. And they reckon they had about 400 people went along to them over the weekend. They had Friday night, Saturday night, and a Sunday kind of family fun day version. And they said that they're going to do another one end of August that's kind of the West End stars singing some Disney songs. So that'll be a really nice one for the kids in the summer. So yeah, I think I really enjoyed it down there. It was great.
Yeah, what about the I-360? Because you went along to the I-360 as well. Obviously that's come under a bit of criticism recently with the with the funding issue there. But I mean, hopefully that will do well this year, because we all need that, don't we, for the I-360 to be well used, because it's been underused over the last year and a half.
Yeah, I really enjoy it on there. And some people say that when you're a resident and you've been once, there's no point going again. But I think there is. I know the view's the same, but it's the experience, isn't it? And it's just lovely to kind of look over the city from there. But yeah, what I went along to was actually a gin tasting flight. And I think that's what they need to look at now, isn't it? Kind of doing some alternative events on there to bring people in. And it was really good, actually. So they had someone there from Brighton Gin talking through how the gin is made, how the company was set up, how they kind of got through lockdown. And then we got to taste some of the lovely Brighton gin and a couple of kind of gin and tonics, gin cocktail. So yeah, that bit was very good. But yeah, I thought it was good. And it's a good sign that they're trying to kind of branch out and hold some different events on there to try and get people on there and yeah, help it make some money, hopefully.
Yeah, you're right. And obviously, you can always get a discount, which a lot of people tend to forget that, yeah, bring along your council tax bill, you'll get a discount as well on each flight, I think, as well. So,
yeah. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
On a clear day, you can't really beat the views of the South Downs, to be fair.
No.
What about Brighton Housing Trust? I know there was that charity event, which we covered on latest TV news. Outside, of course, I know there was an inside one, which was cancelled, at the Velodrome there.
They call themselves BHT Sussex now, don't they? Yeah. Homelessness Charity and Housing in Brighton, and they hold this Bike It Brighton event every year. They weren't able to do it last year, but yeah, unfortunately they had to cancel the inside velodrome race, like you said, but they still had two outside kind of bike rides. And they had about 100 people take part this year, which I think was a record. And yeah, it's they said it's gone really well, and we'll have like a nice little picture spread in the paper this week and on our website as well for people to see. So yeah, it's great that some of these charity events are still going ahead, isn't it? And I think we've got Race for Life coming back to Brighton later in the year, September, I think. And it also includes one of the muddy assault courses.
Yeah.
That children can do as well. So that'll be a nice one. So yeah, lots going on.
Yeah, now I know you're also covering in the Indy this week, the Pride events. We can talk a bit about that because there is some Pride events going ahead. Obviously, the big parade's not taking place. The party definitely isn't taking place, as far as I know.
Yeah.
There are some at the Ironworks, some events taking place there.
Yeah, not quite ready for the parades, I don't think, are we?
No.
In terms of with the COVID restrictions and stuff. Yeah, but it is great that the organisers are still managing to do something, because it would have been a real shame if there was nothing. And I know last year they did a few kind of virtual things. But yeah, now that the restrictions are lifting next week, they're able to hold quite a few things at the Ironworks in September, August and September. There are lots of kind of cabaret type shows and comedians and things like that. So yeah, it should be really good. And yeah, we've got a bit of a preview of what's coming up there in the paper this week as well.
Brilliant. Okay. We'll leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. We'll be discussing a lot more with Nicola about what is going to be in the Brighton Indy. Join us then. So back here for the second half with Nicola Caines, editor of the Brighton Indy. And so, Nicola, what else are you going to be covering this week? Centre Park Sussex is quite an interesting one, isn't it? Because that's going to be quite a draw, I would say, for people not just living in Sussex, but across the south coast. Because I think the nearest one's some distance from here, isn't it, from the Brighton area?
Yeah, so although it's obviously not in Brighton, the plans for this Centre Parks is going to be near Crawley, which isn't very far from us at all, is it? So, and yeah, I've been to Centre Parks. I went to the one in Suffolk last year, literally on the last weekend before lockdown, which was interesting. We were there hearing the news that there'd been like 3 cases of COVID, and we're thinking, oh, this is all right. And then the next weekend, it all kicked in. But yeah, I really enjoyed it at Centre Parks. It's great for families, so much kind of to do there for the families and stuff. So I think it'll be a really positive thing for Sussex as a whole. And like you say, it'll attract people from all over, really. And I think it will probably end up boosting Brighton a bit as well, because people will probably visit that and realise Brighton's only half an hour away. So they'll probably tie in a trip to the seaside as well while they're here. And yeah, the kind of people behind Centre Parks obviously saying it's going to create about 1,500 jobs, a real boost to the local economy, because they'll try and use kind of local suppliers for a lot of stuff. And yeah, I think it'll be good. I think they said their plan was in place before the coronavirus, so it's not responding to staycations, but I think they're just going to get that added kind of bonus of the fact that people are looking for holidays closer to home now, aren't they?
Yeah.
So yeah, I think it'll be good. That's anything for Sussex is good, isn't it? Helps us all, really.
Back to football, obviously, post Euro Championships. Less said about that, the better. So BHFC then, so Brighton and Hove Albion, of course. And that is they've got a new kit out, which looks pretty good for the away games. And then I know that you're going to be covering that in depth with the new season, which starts around about the middle of August, I think, from memory.
Yeah, I think it's about the 14th of August this year, isn't it? Sometimes it's the weekend before, but I didn't know if that's because of the Euros have given them a bit of extra time or something, maybe. But yeah, so gearing up towards that now, which is exciting. Hopefully Brighton can cheer up all the sad England fans. And yeah, so we have a Brighton supplement in the middle of the paper every week, packed full of kind of, at the moment, it's all the transfer news. Obviously this week, Matty Ryan, the goalkeeper's off, isn't he? And all the people that they're bringing in.
Yeah.
And yeah, as we get closer to the season, we'll obviously be having a look in a bit more depth about how we think they're going to get on this season. We kind of featured the fixtures before, but we'll keep those going so people know what's coming up. And we've also, I think next week, possibly we're going to have a competition to win tickets to the first home game as well, which will be good. So yeah, not much of a break really, is it, between the Euros and the league starting. So people who love football, they've not got too long to wait.
Yeah, exactly. Got the Olympics coming in as well. But just finishing up on the Brighton, I mean, obviously, as you say, Matty Ryan's gone over to the Liga, Real Mallorca, I think. I mean, it's going to be interesting with Brighton because they're going to have a full stadium, aren't they, as well? Regulations permitting, going to be lifted. So it means that Brighton can play in front of a capacity crowd. And that should have a bit of a difference on their woeful home form last season.
Yeah, I think it always makes such a difference, doesn't it? And for the fans as well who have missed it, it's that atmosphere of everyone singing in the crowd, all the good Sussex by the Sea and all the other songs the fans have made up. it just creates a good atmosphere. And I think we saw with England as well that the support from the crowd does make a real difference, doesn't it? So, hope that Brighton and obviously, hope they can have a really good season. And, that home form is key, isn't it? Because, need to get all the home wins and hopefully have a good end to the season.
Exactly. What about the Olympics then? I know you've got a bit of a preview for the Olympics, which are going to be in Tokyo, Japan.
Yeah, so again, there doesn't seem to be any any rest from some kind of sport for people to be interested in. So, it's going to be a bit different, isn't it? Because there's still not going to be the crowds and stuff there. But, I love watching a bit of Olympics. It's good, isn't it? And, again, another chance to cheer on your country. And, so we've got a bit of a preview in the paper this week of kind of who we've got competing in some of the big events and things. So, that'll be good.
Yeah, and I was lucky enough to go to the 2012 London Olympics, and so it's going to be interesting having events without crowds because, I went to water polo, football, I think, and table tennis, and, they all had kind of big crowds there, almost capacity, and it made a big difference for the athletes.
Yeah, although I think they'll just be grateful to be able to go and compete, won't they? So. Yeah. Yeah, they'll have to just imagine we're cheering them on from home.
London to Brighton Electric Rally. Now, we're going to be covering that on latest TV news, and it's I know that Councillor Tom Druitt is behind that, the man behind the Big Lemon bus company. So that's going to be interesting. We're going to have some celebrities potentially involved in that as well.
Yeah, so apparently Fatboy Slim's taking part, so that'll be good. I don't know what kind of vehicle he's driving, so that'll be interesting. Yeah, it's always, those kind of events are always lovely, aren't they, when they turn up at Madeira Drive, and you can, obviously people can go down there and see them all arriving on Sunday and have a look at all the different kind of vehicles and stuff. And it's just another nice event for the city. And I think a few celebs and our very own Fatboy Slim supporting that. So, that'll be good.
Yeah. RSPCA Brighton, I know they've got a dog event as well. And I know there's a lot of dog lovers in Brighton. I can see that when I'm doing my workout with all of the dog walkers in early morning. So what's going on there with the RSPCA and them doing?
Yeah, they've got their family fun day and dog show this Sunday. They've obviously been kind of suffering from the restrictions like everyone else, but not been able to let people in to kind of look at rehoming dogs and stuff like that. So it'll be really nice for them to be able to welcome people back in and have a real nice kind of family fun day there on Sunday. So we feature the RSPCA Brighton in the Indy every week. They provide us with a nice picture and some details of an animal that needs rehoming. Not just dogs, we've had cats, we've had ferrets. It is dogs this week, two little kind of Yorkie type dogs. I think they want them to be home together. So if you're interested in getting a couple of little dogs, have a look at that this week. But we try to kind of promote all of these kind of charity events and things in the Indy. And it's just nice that some of the charities and things are able to get back up and running, isn't it? And start getting some much needed kind of donations in, really.
It is. We're going to finish up on teachers, defibrillators. Now, defibrillators came up, didn't they, recently? I think in Bucks, we had that defibrillator, which was vandalised. But they're crucial, aren't they, defibrillators? And they're not funded by the NHS, weirdly, I think nearly all of them, if not all of them, in parks and community centres, etc., are funded through charitable causes.
Yeah, so this is teachers at secondary schools across the city are going to take part in like a sponsored run to try to get a defibrillator for each of the 10 secondary schools in the city. But it's not to say that the schools don't have them already. This is more specifically for kind of outside on the PE fields and stuff. So where some of the schools might have one inside, it is a PE teacher at Blatchington Mill that said that when they're outside on the kind of football pitches and stuff outside, it would be quite a way to go inside to get the defibrillator. And they were actually spurred on by the incident with the Denmark player Ericsson.
Yeah.
And thought it would just be really good to have defibrillators kind of outside on the school fields so that they could have them there if needed. So yeah, that's a really good cause. And we've got a story on them and how you can donate to it. So that'll be good.
Yeah, children and swimming to finish up on then. Is this a push for a record, or what's going on
Yeah, this is another nice charity one. It's a Brighton nurse from the Royal Alexandra Children's Hospital, Annie, and she's a real keen swimmer already. She's been training hard for this challenge. She's going to swim the Channel over to France on July the 28th. But yeah, in her training, she's swum all the way out to the wind farm and back. So yeah, I think she's definitely got the skills to do it. But I think, yeah, it will be the biggest challenge, she said, that she's done so far. And she's been working really hard to train for it. So yeah, all the best to Annie. And yeah, she's going to be raising money for our children's hospital, which is a really great cause as well.
Yeah, a fun pack, 72 pages. And we're going to leave it there, Nicola. So all the best with that. And we'll catch up again next week. Thanks a lot.
Great. Thanks, Mark.